and welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that exposes Pakistan's role and nexus in promoting global terrorism and its funding. Here are the headlines. Pakistani leader Harun Bilor killed in suicide blast at an election rally. Pakistani army and ISI dictating terms in Pakistan polls. Pakistan-backed militants and separatist leaders create chaos in Kashmir. And Pakistan-sponsored terrorist outfits create more problems in Afghanistan. Pakistan is known all over the world for being a terror state, and many terror organizations have originated from their soils for years. Over the years, the Pakistan administration refused to take control of these terror outfits, and as a result, now these organizations have started creating problems for the Pakistan administration as well. Recently, Awami National Party leader Harun Bilor was killed in a suicide bombing attack in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. Newsweek South Asia has a report.
These are the last visuals of Harun Bilor, the Awami National Party leader, leading an election rally before he, with 20 others, was blown off by a suicide bomber in Yakatoot neighborhood of Peshawar city of Pakistan. The explosion occurred moments after Bilor arrived at the venue near the stage to address the supporters at the meeting as party members and admirers engaged in a display of fireworks, which the bomber made use as his cover.
छोटा जो कॉर्नर मीटिंग थी तो उसमें ये इंसिडेंट हुआ है जिसमें अभी तक की इत्तला के मुताबिक 12 लोग शहीद हुए हैं और 32 34 जख्मी हैं मुश्किल लम्हा है
व्हाट इज क्लियर इज दैट ही वाज एंटी पाकिस्तानी तालिबान तेरे के तालिबान पाकिस्तान सो पॉसिबली द पाकिस्तानी आर्मी हैज एलिमिनेटेड हिम सो इट वुड अपीयर दैट एनीबॉडी हु टेक्स अ स्ट्रांग व्यू अगेंस्ट द पाकिस्तानी आर्मी इज अनलाइकली टू सक्सीड and may result into him getting injured or getting killed.
Harun Bilor's death comes hours after Pakistani military warned of security threats. This was a second terrorist attack on an election rally in Pakistan ahead of the general elections. The ANP was the main target of the Taliban attacks in 2013 elections. Then, the senior ANP leader, Bashir Bilor, was killed in a suicide bombing. The recent attack killed his son, Harun Bilor, the candidate for the provincial assembly elections. Expressing his grief through a tweet, chairman of Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf, Imran Khan said, "Sad to learn of Harun Bilor and two other ANP workers' death and strongly condemn the terrorist attack and the ANP corner meeting in Peshawar. All political parties and their candidates must be provided with proper security during their election campaign by the state." Experts across the globe believe that the run-up to the election has been growing increasingly shoddy with the polling dates inching closer. They, however, underscore the possibility of Imran Khan having an edge owing to Pakistan's constant support to him.
Now, Pakistan Muslim League is in flux simply because Mr. Nawaz Sharif cannot contest the elections. As far as People's Party of Pakistan is concerned, their Asif Zardari is not contesting elections. As far as Pakistan is concerned, that is Imran Khan's party, that seems to be the front runner, and it seems to be a favored party of not only the terrorist groups, but also of the Pakistani army. So in all probability, they are going to do much better than what they did earlier.
The assassination has pointed to a strategic and systematic targeting of politicians who do not adhere to an Islamist line or bow to the Pakistan's deep state of the army.
It is very, very clear that Harun Bilor had not been provided security, because if this is not the first time he was attacked, his father had been killed in 2013 in a similar situation. He himself had been attacked twice before this. So it was well known that he was a target of Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan. And even after that, if a terrorist is able to kill him, that very clearly shows that the Pakistani army was not interested in providing him with any security. So therefore, he was killed. And this is exactly what is likely to happen to anybody who's anti-Pakistani army.
Democracy has always been fragile in Pakistan, and it has particularly been marred by a series of dramatic developments in the run-up to the election slated later this month on July 25th. The atmosphere by no means in Pakistan is conducive for a free and fair election, and the situation has only got murkier after the establishment allowed the terror group's mastermind to be mainstream in politics.
Pakistan, which stands on the cusp of being declared a terror state, has stooped to a new political low as it brazenly supports dreaded terrorists like Hafiz Saeed to become part of mainstream. The proscribed terrorist, who has a $10 million bounty over his head, claims to have fielded around 300 candidates for these general elections. Experts across the globe believe that he has got patronage of army establishment of Pakistan. While Hafiz Saeed is being eulogized, Major player Nawaz Sharif and his daughter Maryam, who had the potential of disrupting the designs of army, have been sentenced for a significant period of time behind bars. Newsweek South Asia takes a close look at the rapidly evolving developments in Pakistan politics. Have a look.
This is Hafiz Mohammad Saeed, a known global terrorist, who is freely campaigning for his candidates contesting general elections in Pakistan. This dreaded terrorist has a bounty of $10 million on his head and has fielded his family members, like his son and son-in-law, among the candidates. In a recent election rally, the chief of the Jamaat-ud-Dawah said that his political party was winning the first round of elections.
अमेरिका रुकावटें खड़ी करता था कि इस जमात को इलेक्शन में आने नहीं देना अल्लाह ने फजल फरमाया आपने पहला राउंड जीत लिया
Saeed mentioned that the influence of foreign hands is stopping him from taking part in the elections according to him there was heavy pressure on the Pakistan government for stopping him from contesting Candidate of National Assembly NA-125 Mohammad Yaqub Sheikh said that Hafiz Saeed would work for the liberation of Kashmir and to conquer the mountain of challenges facing Pakistan. As the polling dates approaches, experts are raising concern over growing influence of military and terrorists in the polls.
I've been doing two things. One is exporting their militants across the border in India, Afghanistan and other areas to create chaos and anarchy. Other thing, you know, is to create problem within the Pakistan region as well, you know, to contain nationalism or to contain liberal elements within Pakistan. So it's a deliberate attempt, you know, he's doing it at the behest of the Pakistani military establishment. This thing. Now he is very worried, you know, with Nawaz Sharif has threatened that he is going to come back in Pakistan and launch a fresh movement for democracy. So he is worried. His idea, these people don't want democracy, they don't want rule of law. In the name of, they are using religion to promote their political interest in that region. So they are promoting, you know, that. Pure Islamic state should be created. Pakistan is an Islamic state.
The deep state of the army, which seems to be backing Hafiz Saeed, has been successful in bringing him to the fore. It is being speculated that Nawaz Sharif's PMLN might make a strong comeback, but Pakistan Army and the ISI are backing Saeed to fill his candidate.
You know, Nawaz Sharif, as I mentioned earlier, is going to come back with a big bang. He has a support, he has a very strong support within the Punjab and other areas. Then, you know, he is the only leader in that area. Second thing, he is promoting democracy. which is not liked by the army. You know, if the democratic forces grows or going to gain election or win election, you know, then automatically, you know, the army would be weakened. You know, army's political role would be would not be there. Army Hafiz Saeed is, Nawaz Sharif is promising that the elected government should have more power, and army should not use political power, should not be involved in using political role in the country.
But Nawaz Sharif's sentencing of 10 years just before the elections has raised serious questions among the judiciary of Pakistan.
It is the Pakistan army and ISI which wants to dictate elections in Pakistan, because if you recall, elections are just around the corner, and Pakistan has been pushing a masquerade by creating a new party led by Hafiz Saeed. Hafiz Saeed, who's a banned terrorist worldwide, is not directly contesting the elections, but he's got a rump which is doing so. And they have formed a clandestine arrangement between Imran Khan and these terrorists to form a government later on if it's necessary. While Nawaz Sharif's party has been completely decimated, charges framed against Nawaz Sharif, which are not probably true, but the whole legal process has been manipulated to see to it that Nawaz Sharif does not take place or take participate in the elections, despite being at the moment the most popular leader of Pakistan. So it just goes to show that how army dictates the entire democratic process of that country.
On the other hand, in London, a group of young men, allegedly from the Tehreek-e-Insaf PTI UK chapter, attempted to break in the Evansville residence of Pakistan's former Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif in London. There were heated arguments and clashes between the two groups on London streets. The angry youth also tried to block path of Nawaz Sharif and also surrounded PMLN leader Izaz Gul.
Well, I think it's been orchestrated, because in London, there are no alleged workers of the PTI. The people who attacked Nawaz Sharif's home in London are all agents who function for the ISI. ISI manipulates these people in England, who sometimes raise up banners against India, then go and attack Nawaz Sharif, their own leader. At times, they also coordinate terrorist activities in England. So these are people who are operatives for the ISI based in London.
Experts also say that army has decided that the Islamic organization and combination which are fighting the elections want Imran Khan's party to come to power. History in Pakistan has shown that as the army has decided to rig elections, violence might take place this time as well.
The Indian state of Jammu and Kashmir has always been a target of neighboring Pakistan to create a proxy war in the state. Now, the Pakistan-backed militants have started killing security forces in the state and have also launched grenade attacks in other parts. With the Amarnath Yatra underway, the Indian security forces have an uphill task of ensuring safety in the valley. Newsweek South Asia takes a look.
Pakistan's malicious design to create instability in Jammu and Kashmir has been exposed time and again. However, owing to sustained efforts of Indian security forces, most of their plans have been foiled time and again. The support of the local security forces is one of the main reasons that has led to the success of the operations in the various parts of the state. It is the same reason for which militants have now been targeting the local cops. Last year, Lieutenant Umar Fayaz, who was just 22 years old, was kidnapped, tortured, and brutally murdered by militants while he was attending the family function. Later that year, Mohammad Ayub Pandit became a victim of mob lynching that was led by the Hurriyat leader Mirwayaz Umar Farooq. This year, Aurangzeb, an Indian Army Jawan, and Javed Ahmed Dar, a constable in the Jammu and Kashmir police, were the ones who were killed.
Now these people, what they are doing is, they are attacking the local police personnel and the army chiefs who come on leave, because these are, they are soft targets, and they just want to show it to their people in Pakistan and their the entire, I would say, the hierarchy of the militancy in Pakistan and all, that what we are doing is, we are still active and we are able to, you know, put our stamp on the various activities in Kashmir. So this sort of a thing now is a trend. To counter this, what would have to be done is that the police and the security forces now have to go after the overground and the underground workers, all those who are operating in Kashmir.
The militants continued to carry out strikes in the Kashmir Valley, but security forces have taken all measures to eliminate their designs. Recently, a policeman of the Central Reserve Police Force, CRPF, was injured after militants hurled a grenade on a patrol party in Haidandarpora area. On the other hand, business establishments and markets downed their shutters in Jammu and Kashmir's summer capital, Srinagar, on the death anniversary of separatist militant leader Burhan Wani on July 8 after separatists called for a complete shutdown. This day saw a large number of protests being carried out by the Pakistani-funded Hurriyat.
It is an established fact that Pakistan is the main conduit for the money that is coming in into Kashmir Valley, and all these militant organizations are receiving it. Now it is very clear, because the NIA has now established the money trail coming in from the Middle East, from Saudi Arabia and other Arabian countries, Muslim countries, into the valley through various channels to the militant leaders, and these separatist leaders are giving it further to the militant leaders and also distributing it amongst the stone pelters. These all have been documented, and a very established chain of money trail that is there has been also established by the NIA. And you see that quite a few people have also been put behind bars, and their trials are going on right now. Now, what has to be done is that these money trail and these people who are receiving the money have to be immediately arrested and put behind bars so that justice can be done. Second is that these stone pelters and others have to be now taken under psychological guidance. The government of the day has to ensure that you have proper psychology and psychological counseling, and also this major thing is that a counter propaganda, counter brainwashing on the social media is to be required.
On July 10th and 13th, encounters were carried out in Shopian and Anantnag district of Jammu and Kashmir. In the Shopian encounter, two militants were killed, but in the Anantnag encounter, two policemen lost their lives. The gun battle broke out in Kundalan village of Shopian after security forces launched a search operation after getting a tip-off about presence of militants in the area. Reportedly, the Anantnag area of the encounter has been cordoned off, and a search operation is underway to track down militants who launched the attack.
Shopian district is the hotbed of terrorism, the hotbed of militancy, because the reason being is a lot of orchards and other things are there. There are a lot of cover, camouflage, concealment can be done, and there is, I would say, easy money coming in. There is also a lot of drugs that are playing a role over there, and these people who are now actually picking up the gun, they are picking up the gun just to, in that Rambo image, to show to their girlfriends and to their friends that, look, I am also a strong man and I picked up a gun and a thing like this. Now, the what is required here is that these people who are now picking up the gun, their parents have to be counseled that, look, what you are doing is you have to get back your child, because if you don't get him back, he is going to be eliminated. Now, we saw the Ramzan ceasefire that was given, a united ceasefire that was given by the government of India, was just to consolidate the peace process that was being carried out, also the back channel diplomacy that was being carried out, and also give a chance to these militants to surrender and come down to the mainstream. But we have seen that this has not worked that way, because there have been more killings during the Ramzan ceasefire than was otherwise. Therefore, now what is required is a total operation, what all out that was already on, has to be conducted all over again.
The incidents of violence perpetrated by the terrorists and stone pelters are affecting the common people of Jammu and Kashmir. Be it the Haqqani Network, Taliban or the Lashkar-e-Toiba, Pakistan remains a safe haven for these dreaded terror organizations. These terror organizations are working on the behest of Pakistan's army and intelligence agencies and are creating mayhem in the Indian state of Jammu and Kashmir since 1989.
Parliamentary elections in the state of Afghanistan are scheduled to be held in October this year. However, non-state actors like the Islamic State and the Taliban have intensified their attacks on the streets and on voter registration centers as a whole. Newsweek South Asia has a report.
The security situation in Afghanistan is getting out of control as the Taliban and the Islamic State has intensified its attacks. On July 10, 12 civilians and two security force members were killed in a suicide bomb attack in Jalalabad city, capital of the Nangarhar province. Although no terror group claimed responsibility for the attack, more questions have been posed in front of the Ashraf Ghani government before the elections.
My sense is that the Afghan government is very keen to go ahead with this election, and therefore, even if there are certain constraints and there are even obstacles on the way, particularly as far as the physical security of the country is concerned, there would be a political determination to go ahead with the election. Because today, NATO is also discussing Afghanistan, and one of the metrics that has been applied for continuing international support to Afghanistan is a sense that they are moving towards democracy and that elections can be held or will be held.
Though Pakistan claims to have been fighting against terrorism, it is believed Pakistan Army has been targeting selective terror groups. The rest, including the Taliban and Haqqani Network, work under the patronage of Pakistan Army and spy agencies, the ISI.
No, this is a recurring problem in Pakistan. I would say in many ways this is the fundamental problem, the support by Pakistan and the army and the intelligence agencies to those terror groups that are threatening the Afghan government and the people of Afghanistan. So unless there is a political process and some kind of pressure is brought to bear on Rawalpindi, I do not expect that there will be any significant change in the ground situation.
Terror organizations based in Pakistan want to overthrow the democratic government in Afghanistan as they have no faith in the so-called democratic laws and demand the establishment of the Sharia law in the state. The problem, however, would start when the terrorist organizations based in Pakistan would march towards overthrowing the Pakistan government if they destroy democracy in Afghanistan.
Well, Pakistan feels, at least the army in Pakistan, they are of the view that they can continue to support terror groups against India and against Afghanistan and get the Americans to focus on those terror groups that are attacking Pakistan, for instance, the Pakistan Taliban. How long they can get away with this is a bit of a question mark, because we are aware that once you nurture the forces of terrorism and such ideology, they will weaken the state. You know, when Mrs. Hillary Clinton was the US Secretary of State, she had a very famous line saying that if you keep snakes in your backyard, you cannot complain if they start biting you at some point. So like that, I think these are very corrosive forces. And civil society in Pakistan knows about this, but for some reason, the Pakistani establishment and the military are not convinced.
We With just 3 months remaining until the election, the Afghan government will need to convince its citizens that it is capable of holding free and fair elections and safeguarding them while doing so. If it cannot protect voters and successfully carry out an election, the legitimacy of the government and its democratic institutions will suffer.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Mariam signing off on behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.